It takes many stepping stones, you know, for a man to rise. None can do it unaided. Bonanno family has always been thought of as the Castellamarese family of Brooklyn. But its origins go back to several related mafiosi from small towns like Campo Reale, Roccamegna, and Partenico. The Campo Reale group arrived first, possibly led by Antonio Governale, and settled in Williamsburg, Brooklyn. In 1906, Paolo Orlando, the head of a family in Tunis, arrived to take over leadership. Tunisian boss Orlando and Governale from Campo Reale, Niccolo Sciro from Roccamegna, and Salvatore Grippi from Partenico were all related and constituted a leadership group. From the early 1900s, a community of immigrants from Castellamare began forming in Williamsburg, and as both groups lived in the same area, they soon combined. The first leader of this family appears to have been Sebastiano de Gaetano from Castellamare. The Castellamarese community continued to grow and began to dominate the family. De Gaetano may have been appointed temporary national head after Morello and Lupo were jailed in 1910. Salvatore Clemente told the Secret Service in 1912 that de Gaetano had lost his nerve and retired. Niccolo Sciro, the yeast broker, succeeded him, and allied with the Corleone's Maneo factions to oppose Salvatore de Aquila's family. Niccolo Sciro continued as boss of the Castellamarese clan until the 1920s, when a formidable new enemy appeared. Intimidated by Giuseppe Masseria, Sciro lost the respect of his family and fled, leaving them leaderless. Maranzano succeeded Masseria after plotting with Luciano to take the throne by force, promising promotion and advancement for Lucky, and led the family out from the conflict known as the Castellamarese War. Maranzano, in turn, named the top mafiosi, who would head the brotherhood in each given city, and helped to design their hierarchy based on the old Roman legions of Caesar. This new arrangement established the now familiar hierarchy, a structure that holds to this day. This council allowed family bosses to discuss affairs and vote on disputes before they turned into violence. Families from diverse locations were to gather in Chicago and hear how Salvatore Maranzano defeated Joe Masseria with the help of champion Lucky Luciano. They were to hear a new structure for organized crime that was destined to change the face of the Italian mafia. In May 1931, Stefano Magaddino planned on attending this important mafia summit with his brother Antonio and cousin Peter. Because of his active role in the Castellamarese family, Magaddino was in an important position among national crime bosses. To come along to Chicago to mingle with the nation's top mafiosi, he invited his close friend and advisor, John Montana, the number three man in Buffalo's mafia behind Stefano Magaddino and his brother Antonio. Montana allegedly went to Chicago to watch the future of the mafia change before his eyes while he was an elected member of the Common Council. In the self-embellished biography of Joe Bonanno, the former Brooklyn mafia boss talks of John Montana's trip to the Chicago conference. Bonanno, who is Stefano Magaddino's younger cousin, went to the national summit by train from New York with a contingent of men, including Lucky Luciano and Salvatore Maranzano. The train stopped at Central Terminal on the east side to pick up Buffalo's mafia leaders. According to Bonanno, We all boarded the same train for Chicago. In Buffalo, Stefano Magaddino and his right-hand man, John Montana, and Pete Magaddino, my cousin, also got on the train. Maranzano got off the train to make a phone call. A half hour passed. Maranzano didn't return. The train was scheduled to leave the station momentarily. It was unthinkable to abandon Maranzano. Montana got off the train. Montana was an illustrious man in Buffalo. He opened the cab company, and at one time he was the city's deputy mayor. When he returned to our compartment, Montana told us he had arranged for the train to wait until Maranzano came back. This exhibition of clout impressed us greatly. After Maranzano boarded again and we were on our way, my cousin Stefano beamed with pride. "See what kind of men I have under me," Stefano said. "John could stop trains." Maranzano unfortunately mistreated his subordinates, including Luciano. His Roman Empire-inspired power trip was coming to an end, when Maranzano thought he could control the circles Lucky was involved with at the time, specifically his Jewish friend Meyer Lansky. Evidently, Maranzano was impassioned with even more despotism than Masseria was. So Luciano and his crew began plotting against the Little Caesar. At the consequence of Maranzano's vow of equality revoked, Luciano arranged his death. At the same time, Maranzano became cautious once he saw that Lucky wasn't showing respect the way he thought they would have intended. Once Lucky's plot to take over as head of the families became more apparent, Maranzano hired a hitman named Vincent Mad Dog Call to take out Luciano and Vito Genovese in September 1931. Lansky helped Luciano find out about the hit and sent three guys to Maranzano's office on the ninth floor of the Helmsley building, where they disarmed Maranzano's guards and stabbed and shot Salvatore Maranzano to death. The men ran into Call on the stairs and warned him there had been a raid while he was coming up. Call, who was 23 at the time, fled. He was eventually taken out on a $50,000 contract in February 8, 1932. The pictures of Maranzano's body laying in his office are the only known photographs of Maranzano to exist, and there are mainly sketches to use as reference for his appearance in life. There are some fake photos that are seen, but it is possible that someone has a picture tucked away somewhere, a descendant of a family friend, or maybe an old hermit who doesn't even know who the guy is. Lucky decided to keep Maranzano's new blueprint together, with a twist. He planned to operate the modern mafia like a corporation, calling it the Commission. With his boss dead, Bonanno decided he should make peace with Lucky Luciano if he wanted to continue his path with less resistance. So they organized a meeting. "I don't have any reason to have any problems with you. Do you have any problems with me?"
Lucky Luciano awarded Joseph Bonanno leadership of the Maranzano family. Following in the footsteps of his predecessor and mentor, Joseph Bonanno inherited his boss's stake and became one of the youngest bosses of a crime family at 26. Claiming with Lucky Luciano's final reorganization of the five New York families in 1931 after the Castellamarese War. 2 months after Maranzano was murdered, Joe Bonanno married Faye Labruzzo. With the war behind them, at the ceremony several of the bridegrooms carried pistols in their tuxedos in case of surprise visitors. A year later, they had a son, and they named the boy Salvatore after his grandfather, but he later went by Bill. The Tower of Pisa is made by Bonanno. In the words of Bill Bonanno, "Even in those days we couldn't do anything straight. You know, we built the crooked building." Signs of leadership skills are often manifested in the household. Learning from family members' demonstrations at gatherings and meals. This was the job of the men, as well as the women of the clan. With the fathers and uncles teaching and conditioning the young one to be a certain way, so did the woman help in building them up. Joe Bonanno's maternal grandmother was Stefano Magaddino's sister. He had a close relationship with Joe Profaci, who was head of Profaci family, one of the other five families in New York City. Joseph's nickname growing up was Joey Bananas, which was a name he despised because it implied that he was crazy. His family was sometimes called the Bananas family, after his nickname. A much safer nickname to use around him was Don Peppino, a diminutive of his original Italian name. Bonanno joined the Maranzano crew when he was just 19 years old, but was very well read in contrast to his criminal colleagues. Wisely, he believed a renewed war with Luciano would serve no purpose, since Luciano only wanted to run his own rackets. The two bosses went their separate ways. Lucky Luciano became a household name, while Joe Bonanno remained unknown to the public. He must have noticed Lucky got into trouble being in photographs, where he loved being in the spotlight. You would see him at clubs, in the society columns, and on newspapers. But Joe Bonanno managed to stay out of the newspapers for over a decade. Joe concentrated on the traditional staples of mafia business, bookmaking, gambling, and loan sharking. But extortion and violence was inevitable. Joe believed if he instilled enough fear in his followers, then he wouldn't ever have to resort to violence. One cannot actually be a mob boss, especially in New York, without being responsible for many murders, which he probably did order numerous murders. Magaddino named his upper cabinet with a soto capo, a consigliere, and several capo da decina. In time, they augmented their troops by inducting more men into the brotherhood as soldati, who they deemed fit and worthy of the position. Years later, Bonanno claimed not to have known about the plot to eliminate Maranzano, and only learned later that Maranzano had planned to kill Luciano due to a falling out over influence in the garment district. With the support of Buffalo crime family boss Stefano Magaddino, Bonanno also expanded into Canada,